Can you hear the sound of freedom? We're free because the curse of sin has been broken. And Jesus Christ has set us free.
Pray. I'm a It'll make more sense in a minute. We're just going to start at verse number 19. It says, "Or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and you are not your own? For you were bought at a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's." Mark chapter 16, verse 15. "Then he said, go into the world, go everywhere, and announce the message of God's good news, one and to all." I'm just going to go back and reread it with a little bit more dynamism and enthusiasm. He says, "Or do you not know that your body is the temple or the sanctuary or the tabernacle or the dwelling place of the Holy Spirit, whom you have from God, and you are not your own?" Just look at somebody and say, "I belong to God." "For you were bought at a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's." Then he said, "Go into the world, go everywhere, and announce the message of God's good news, one and to all." And for the next few moments, I just want to preach from the subject, "The church has left the building." The church has left the building. Hallelujah. Just want to start off by saying that I'm not a preacher who was called to preach what's popular. I haven't prepared anything to tickle your ears. I don't have a gimmick or a jingle or a joke or a poem or a nursery rhyme. And I will never manipulate and twist the scriptures and try to force them into saying something that God isn't saying in order to get you to do something that I want you to do. But I was called to articulate the heart of God. And today we didn't come for games, we didn't come for manipulation, we didn't come for enticing words, but we have simply come to eat the word of God. With that being said, I want to share some light on ecclesiology. Somebody say ecclesiology.
Ecclesiology.
Ecclesiology is the study of the doctrine of the church. And I came to dispel and to dismiss many common stereotypes as it pertains to the church and modern day Christianity. Now we're going to go into the depth of the word, so all I ask is that you will put on your intellect and that you will sit praying with me. Are you willing to work, people of God? All right, we're going to work it out. In this sermon, I want to address questions about the church. What is the church? Is the church a building? Is it a place where believers gather to worship? What is the role or the functioning of our church in our everyday lives? Or are the people the church? The believers who follow Christ? How we understand and perceive the church is vitally important in determining how we live and how we walk out our faith. Jesus was once asked the question, when the kingdom of God will come. Luke chapter 17, verse 21 says, "Then came these striking words," and I'm reading from King James Version, "Neither shall they say, lo here or lo there, for behold, the kingdom is within you." In other words, Jesus is saying that when it comes to the kingdom, it is not something that people will be able to see. It is not something that people will be able to point to. People won't be able to say, look, the kingdom is over here, or look, the kingdom is over there in that location, because the kingdom is within us. With these words, Jesus gave voice to a teaching that is universal and timeless. Just look into every great wisdom, spiritual, and religious tradition, and we find this same precept that life's ultimate truth, its ultimate treasure, lies within us. Yes. As Jesus made it unambiguously clear, this inner treasure can be directly experienced. And how many of you know that no experience could be more valuable? But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, he declares, and all of these things shall be added unto you. In other words, Jesus is saying that it is from this interior plane of life that we will gain all that is needful and required in order for us to live a satisfying and fulfilled life. Now, throughout the ages, cross-culturally, Elder Darty, this inner treasure has been referred to by many different names. Plato refers to it as the good and the beautiful. Aristotle, being. Plotinus as the infinite. Ralph Waldo Emerson as the Word. St. Bernard of Clairvaux as the Oversoul. In Taoism, it is called the Dao. In Judaism, it is called Ein Sof. Amongst Australian Aborigines, it is called the Dream Time. And amongst tribes along the Kosciuszko, it is called Unhum Ubuntu. Now, the names may change, but the inner reality that they all point to is one and the same. It is understood cross-culturally in every case that this inner transcendental reality can be directly experienced. Now, for the purposes of this study, we're going to look at the idea of the church in the context of the Christian church, which is a New Testament concept. This is very important for us to understand because somewhere along the lines, believers in this generation have mixed so much Old Testament tradition into where God has called us to be at today. And there is a difference. Nothing in the Old Testament was ever designed to be lived or to walk out by New Testament believers. Paul goes as far as to say, and when I talk to my buddies, we like to have theological conversations about the Bible, and we call Paul an extremist. And Paul went as far as to say that, first of all, we know that the law couldn't be kept, which is why we had to have a new covenant or a New Testament. But Paul, the Israelites, he said that it is absolutely essential that you circumcise all of the male offspring 8 days from birth, Landis. He said that you have to circumcise all male offspring 8 days from birth. Now, we know that circumcision is the cutting away or the removing of the flesh. God said in order for you to be a part of Israel, he said it's absolutely essential that you cut away or remove the flesh from the male private area. But under a new covenant, we have a different perspective. Somebody say it's spiritual now. God is saying to the church that in order for you to be a part of spiritual Israel, also known as the body of Christ, he said it is absolutely essential that you undergo spiritual circumcision. Yeah. He says in order for you to be Christ-like, you have to cut away or remove the flesh, that old flesh nature that is sinful. No longer a physical circumcision of the flesh, but now it is a spiritual circumcision of the heart. You don't love the word. So let me tell you about my Jesus. God commanded the Israelites through Moses. He gave them a particular command. He gave them a set of rituals or a complicated code of sacrifices. These sacrifices, Dr. Amos, had to be performed again and again, year after year. These sacrifices usually involved the death of an animal, a sheep or a cow, for example. These sacrifices had to be killed in a defined way, which usually involved them being burned at an altar. These sacrifices points to the need of a death in order to take away sin and guilt. But the sacrifices under the law were never able to completely meet this need, but rather they point forward to the one perfect sacrifice in Jesus. The blood of goats and bulls and the ashes of young cows could cleanse people's bodies from ritual defilement, but it was only a temporary fix. But now that the church has been given the blood of Jesus, he will purify and cleanse our hearts. Somebody say the blood. He will purify and cleanse our hearts. These sacrifices under the old system had to be made again and again, year after year, but they were never able to provide perfect cleansing to those who came to worship. But now that we have been cleansed perfectly, there is therefore now no condemnation, Romans chapter 8 and 1, to them who are in Christ, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Somebody say, in with the new,
in with the new.
Out with the old.
Out with the old.
Old systems, old habits, old patterns, old ways of thinking, old ideologies, old methodologies. You are coming in with the new. God said, remember not the former things. He said, behold, I do a new thing. They that wait upon the Lord shall gain new strength. He's given us new mindsets, new visions, new revelation, new mentalities, new ideologies, new lines of thinking. God has given us something new. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things have passed away. Behold, all things are made new. Somebody say new.
New.
Now I hear somebody saying, but God doesn't change. I hear somebody, First Lady Jones, they saying, God don't change. They said, Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. God said, I am the Lord, and I change not. Joshie said it, and I totally agree with you. God doesn't change, but his methods change. His systems change. If God's methods didn't change, we would all have an animal up here today. If his methods didn't change, the Bible said where the first Adam fell, and an entire nation fell under sin by the second Adam. Somebody say, new.
No.
An entire world would have a right to salvation. Yes. So God is doing something new in our lives. Now, when understanding the idea of the church, in the context of the Christian church, we're going to go to Matthew chapter 16, verse 16 through 18. You can just write it down if you're not there, if you're taking notes. The first person to mention the New Testament church was Jesus Christ. Now, Jesus said in Matthew chapter 16, verse 16 through 18, he was having a conversation with Peter. And Peter said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus replied, he said, "Flesh and blood hasn't revealed this unto you." He says, "But only my Father which is in heaven." He says, "So blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah." And he said, "You are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it," Sister Bunny. So when you're talking about this passage, it is interpreted so many different ways by so many different denominations. And the text was on Peter's declaration. Peter said that you are the Christ. During a very controversial time, Jermaine, Jesus said that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. So Jesus said, and I'm paraphrasing, he said, "You ain't been walking in the flesh. You've been walking in the spirit." He said, "There is no way that you could have known that," because he wasn't revealing who he was. So he said, "Flesh and blood couldn't have revealed that unto you, but only God could have told you that." So he's saying, based off of your confession and your declaration, he is saying that your confession that I am the Christ, the Son of the living God, is the rock-like truth upon which the church is founded. He is saying that your confession is sure, it is stable, it is unwavering, and it is concrete. Somebody say the church. Now, when you look at what Jesus told Peter, and you look at America, there are seven pillars to society. There are seven pillars to society, and we know, Sister Cookie, that a pillar is something that holds up an infrastructure, it holds up a building, it is a support beam. If you remove a pillar, Kalandra, from a building, the building is going to collapse, period. The building is going to collapse. So a pillar is a support system, and it holds up and it maintains a building. So when you look at America, there are seven pillars that hold up America. There are seven pillars, if you're taking notes, that holds up America. It's family, religion, business, arts and entertainment, education, media, and government. It's family, religion, business, arts and entertainment, education, media, and government. Every pillar is under attack. Every pillar is under attack, and out of all of the pillars that there is only one pillar that will stand. Our businesses are corrupt. Our educational systems are corrupt. Arts and entertainment and media, perverted, satanic. Our marriages, forget it. Families, messed up, dysfunctional. The only pillar that is holding up America is the church. God says, "I build my rock on this church, Victoria," and he says that the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. So even though the church is under attack, the church is unwavering. The church is unwavering. And God says, he calls the church salt. He calls the church salt. He says, "You are the salt of the earth." Now we know that, especially us, we know salt brings out flavor in food. Like salt. Salt brings out flavor in food. So God is saying that it is your job as believers to bring out the God flavors within the earth. But salt is good for more than just food, Pastor Darty, Superintendent. It's good for more than just food. Salt is also a sustaining agent and a preservative, which means our job is to preserve the things that are around us. Our job is to influence and sustain our community. We should be able to sustain our school system. We should be able to sustain our leadership, our government. When the church goes into a neighborhood, crime rates should go down. When your children who are saved go into the school system should get better. Because we are the salt of the earth. Now when you look at the word church as rendered in the New Testament, it comes from a Greek word called ecclesia. It comes from a Greek word called ecclesia, Pastor Smith. And that word ecclesia comes from two words that we get: an assembly and to call out. So when you put those two words together, an assembly and to call out, that means that we are the called out ones. So in other words, the church has been called out of the world by God to live under the authority and under the dominion of Jesus Christ. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 22 through 23. So the church has been called out on God. It is a group of believers who started on the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2. And it will continue to flourish. It will continue to thrive. and it will continue to grow until the second coming and until the rapture of Jesus Christ.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, when speaking of the church, it can be referred to in two majorly different senses.
All right.
It can be referred to in a compact scale, very small, localized scale, or it can be referred to in a very broad or very large and vast spectrum.
All right.
And we get two terms, if you're taking notes, the local church versus the universal church.
All right.
The local church versus the universal church. Yeah. Now, the local church is defined as a local assembly of believers or a congregation that meets together physically for worship, fellowship, teaching, prayer, encouragement, and exhortation. The purpose of the local church is to bring believers to spiritual maturity, which is Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25. At the local church level, we are able to live in relationship with other believers. We break bread together in the form of communion. We pray corporately. We disciple. We strengthen and we empower. But the universal church is a little bit different. The universal church is made up of every single believer who has ever walked the face of the earth and exercised their faith and trust in Jesus Christ, regardless of if they ever joined a local assembly or not. I don't like that type of teaching. I said regardless of if they ever connected to a local church, if they have accepted Jesus Christ into their hearts, and if they have been transformed, they are part of the universal church. You can find this in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, and you can find it in Ephesians chapter 1. Now, the problem that we see today is that people have an issue or they have trouble distinguishing the difference between the two. They don't understand the difference between the two churches. The local church is where confusion is birthed. The local church is where division is formed. It's where separation occurs. It's where denominations are fashioned. Acts chapter 2, the church got its start. The Bible says that thousands of souls were added to the church daily. The Bible would say in one passage, 2,000 souls were added to the church. Another passage would say 5,000 souls were added to the church daily. Now, if you look at any denomination, the oldest denomination we have is Catholic Church. And it's definitely the oldest denomination. Every other denomination, not over 200 years old. The New Testament church was birthed 2,015 years ago. Thousands of souls were added to the church daily, which means before your denominations ever existed, people was getting saved. Can we go help? I got some help. My mama said I got some help. When you look at the word denomination, and I talk to my brothers and my friend all the time, we talk about the Bible every single day. We get into these discussions. And when I look at my brothers and my co-laborers in Christ, Uncle Vernon, when I look at them who are part of the denomination, again, I'm not throwing shade because I think denominations are great. I was a part of the denomination, got a strong foundation, Sister Cookie. But the thing with denominations is, if you are in one, I always ask that you understand what it is and why you're a part of it. And for the sake of all that lives, please don't say because my grandmama was. Please don't say because my mama them was. The Bible says work out your own soul salvation with fear and trembling. It says study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that need not be ashamed, rather divide the word of truth. So when I look at denominations, for years, and many people who know me, you know that I worked at McDonald's. I started as a cook person and I went all the way up. I was running my store. I was store manager. My brother, Antoine Jones, his dad, owned 7 of them. And he remembers these days. It was fun times. And we learned a lot of valuable lessons. But one of the things that we were responsible for was counting down the deposit, counting down money, and making sure all of that was good at the end of the night. And what we did, we would have thousands of dollars in the safe. And the first thing that we had to do, Chris know what I'm talking about, McDonald's. The first thing that we had to do, we had to count all of the money. And the first thing we had to do was we had to separate the money into various denominations. We had to separate the money into various denominations. Now when you look at that separation, we will put the hundreds in one stack, we will put the 50s in another stack, we will put the 20s in another stack, we will put the 10s, the 1s, the 5s, nickels, pennies, quarters, and dimes. It will all be separated. And what I found out about that, when I looked at it, in every category of money, the money still had power. The money still had spending ability. The money was still a medium of exchange. Mama K, we could go anywhere and we could purchase something with each individual separated category of money. But at the end of the day, we had to put the money all back together. And the money had its greatest value. It had its greatest power. And it became one. That's good. I like that. I came up with that. That was good. Sometimes my wife, she'll give me these, and I love my wife. Let me just say that. I love my wife. All men love their wives, right? They are good men, they are prime rib. Sometimes my wife, she gives me these strange tasks that I don't understand. And God bless us to celebrate 3 years of marriage. Make it. This is awesome. And sometimes she gives me these strange tasks. And I don't really understand how she thinks. I don't get it. I don't think I'll ever get it. And sometimes she tells me some things to do. And she's never told me this, but we'll just say for the sake of conversation. She may say, hey, babe, I want some Skittles. Talk about the nominations. She said, hey, I want some Skittles. I say, yes, dear. And she say, but I want you to separate them into various colors. Well. So that means I would have to put each Skittle into a different denomination by color. Which means that we would have green Skittles, we would have red Skittles, we would have orange Skittles, blue Skittles, purple Skittles, but at the end of the day, they're all Skittles. This same mentality has sifted its way into the church. So now instead of Christians, we got Lutheran Christians, Apostolic Christians, Baptist Christians, Cogent Christians, Episcopalian Christians, Catholic Christians, AME Christians, when God has called us to be the church. He has called us to be one. He has not called us to be separated. He has not called us to be divided. Because you move in your greatest strength when you are unified. The Bible lets us know that the place of agreement is the place of power. The Bible says in Acts chapter 2, on the day of Pentecost, when the Spirit of the Lord was fully come, that they all went into the upper room. They went into one place with the same mind. Somebody say agreement.
Agreement.
After they were all on one accord, the Bible says that the Spirit of the Lord filled the room and set on each and every individual because they were in agreement. The Bible says, if any two of you agree as in touching, asking anything in my name, he says, that will I do. God wants the church to move in power. If we're going to have mimetic aspirations of the early church, it is important that we get on one accord.
Yes.
We got to get back on one accord. And the enemy knows that in order to strip the church of his power, he's got to separate us. Because what I look at when I study the word, and I have my books out, I have my computer out, but when I study the word, I always ask God not to let me think traditionally. I ask him to let me see like you see. Unveil your truths and give me revelation. And my pattern that I see is that every single time Paul talked, he was the bishop of the New Testament church. Whenever Paul addressed a church, you never see him say River of Hope Church of God in Christ. You never hear him say Bedside Baptist, I'm correcting you because of this. You never see him say boom, One Way Apostolic. You don't see that. When you see Paul write, you see Paul say, I'm addressing the church at Corinth. You see him say, I'm addressing the church in Ephesus. I'm addressing the church in Philippi. Which means that he looked at the church as one conglomerate region. Which means we should be the church of Indianapolis. Evangelist Hunt. We should just be the church of Chicago. There should be no separation. And we get to the place of unity and agreement. Then the Bible says that one of you will chase 1,000 devils. He says two of you will put 10,000 to flight. I like to say three of us can chase 1,000,000 and the rest is history. Somebody say the church.
The church.
look at it, who is the church? Is this okay?
Yeah.
The founder of the home church movement in England came as Ernest Southcott. And I like to look at and listen to different people. Canaan Ernest Southcott, he is the founder of the home church movement in England. He says that the holiest moment of a church service is the moment when God's people, strengthened by preaching and sacrament, go out of the church door into the world to be the church. We don't just go to church, we are the church. The church, therefore, is not a place. It is not a building. It is not in a location. It is not in a denomination. But we, God's people, are the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. If you believe it, put your hands together and give God some praise. Everybody say, I'm the church. And if you're taking notes, the purpose of the church, and I'm bringing it all together and I'm bringing it to a close, the purpose of the church is twofold. The church comes together, Pastor Keith, or it assembles for the purposes of bringing members to spiritual maturity. That's Ephesians chapter 4, Pastor Bevins, and 13. The church reaches out or it scatters to spread the love of Jesus Christ and the gospel message of to unbelievers and to the world. This is Matthew chapter 28, verse 18 through 20. It's called the Great Commission. So the purpose of this church is to minister to believers as well as unbelievers. The church, in both a universal and in a local sense, is important because it is one of the main vehicles by which God carries out his purposes in the earth. Your local church is not to be worshipped. Your denomination is not to be worshipped. Your pastor is not to be worshipped. We superhero our pastors. We put them on a pedestal and we make them superstars and we pervert the gospel. I told my wife, no shame to nobody. I said, well, I said, we're not sitting in no pulpit. There's nothing wrong with it if you do. I said, but I want to exude humility in everything that I do. I said, my greatest calling is that I'm a brother in Christ first. Pastor, that's my title. That's not who I am. Call me there. Call me there. My spiritual conference is Traders Point Christian Church, Pastor Aaron Brockin, and I was so shocked because I haven't been exposed to other cultures of churches, predominantly Caucasian, predominantly Caucasian congregation. And when I first went to him, I talked to him a couple weeks ago, give him an update on the service, and I said, hey, Pastor Brockin, told him what was going on, and he said, first, he said, call me Aaron. I don't understand it. He said, call me Aaron. He said, I'm your brother.
Right.
He said, it's not Traitor's Point against Speck.
Right.
He said, we're on the same side. He said, my greatest calling is to be your brother in Christ. He said, that's my greatest calling. He said, so call me Aaron. You've taken away the pastor part. That don't make me any more or less of what God called me to be. We've got to exercise humility. I've seen so much perversion in churches superheroing their pastor that it is sickening, Landon. I can throw up. It's crazy. Because the greatest among you should be the least. So as I bring it to a close, you've got to understand that 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 27, it says, now you are the body of Christ. And each one of you, Jeremy, is a part of it. Now you got to understand that the power and the treasure is within you. The possibilities are there. The potential is there, Dr. Johnson. The authority is there. But it does not reach its full potential or maturation until it is released. It doesn't reach its full potential until it's released. When I was a kid, when I was little, and thank God I've got a son, Jackson. Me and my wife had our son. He's on the second row, 11 months old. He's the joy of my life. He's amazing. Thank God for a fatherhood to change your life. And the way that we raised Jackson ain't the way y'all used to raise us. Listen, the stuff that they did with us back in the day, my mama was giving me tips. I said, no more tips. I know you know what you're doing. But the thing is, when they had us, I'm worried, we came to the hospital, we was eating cereal. We was drinking water. Hey, listen. listen, now this was bad. They would boil a pot of greens, drain the greens out of the water, and put the green juice in a bottle. And they would give it to us. And they thought it was okay. She said, look at me now. I guess I turned out all right. But listen, I worked at Riley Hospital as of the last 3 months. I worked at Riley Hospital for a couple years. If you do the stuff that they did with us now, they will call Child Protective Services on you. Leslie knows what I'm talking about. She worked at Riley too. They will call DCS on you. Because it got to the point my son had real bad acne when he was about 3 months. Terrible all over his body, all over his face. It looked terrible. And I was worried. I was concerned about it. So I looked at a couple things. And online they said, hey, just give your kids some water. This is what all my mom said. Went everywhere online. They said, give your kids some water. It'll help clear up their skin. Perfectly natural. No chemicals in it. So it's a good idea. Talked to my mom. She's like, oh, yeah, we got y'all water. Y'all good to go. Water's good. Man, I went to work. I told the nurse, I said, hey, we're giving our son water. She said, what? Eyes got huge. She said, don't do that. She said, that's the quickest way to kill your baby. Oh. She said, your baby will die. I said, don't say that. And she said, no, if you give your baby, she gave me the scientific doctor explanation. She said, if you give your baby water, then it'll make their pH balances imbalanced and it will cause them to seize. She says, studies have shown this, medical research proves it. She says, do not give them water, whatever you do. So we cannot raise kids now like they did then. When Jackson got sick, I felt really bad because I knew I gave him the cold. And he got so sick, and I asked everybody, I said, what can I do to help my son? They said, can't do nothing, just get a humidifier, suction out his nose. But when we was little, my mom go to the store. A bag of lemons, and she would roll the lemons out and cut them up, put them in the stove on some water, and boil them until everything on the inside of the lemons was released into the water. Now, when she boiled the lemons, she would boil them for hours, then she would give them to us, and she would rub us down in something they call tallow. I know y'all don't know what that is. She would rub us down in tallow or some type of salve, and we would get under the covers, and we would sweat. And we noticed the very next morning we got up, either the cold was gone or it was completely broken off. Our coughs were productive and we were getting up phlegm. But when I look at this and compare it to the church, what was good about this analogy is that everything the lemons had in them, they had it in them from the beginning. But it wasn't effective until we saw the lemons release what they had on the inside of them. Which means the same thing with the church. You cannot truly be effective until God releases everything on the inside of you to the world. We got to go out into the world and we got to compel men to come. This is what the Bible says in Acts chapter 1 and 8. It says that you shall receive power. This is what we like to quote. You shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and we stop. But what is that power for? He says to be witnesses to men. He says to go into Judea and Samaria and to Jerusalem and all of the uttermost parts of the earth. And we are going to truly be effective in the kingdom and do what God has called us to do. And if we're going to see power in the church like never before, we have got to get up and we have got to go out and we've got to minister to a dying world. And then we will see things that we've never seen before. We will see God move on another level because the church is not in the building, but the church has got to go to the world. If you got blessed by that, just give God some praise. Just give God some praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, everybody. Stand up on your feet. Hallelujah. Church has left the building. Church has left the building. We got to stop sitting in the church, swapping church members. It's a harvest in the world. According to my research and statistics, Josh, 1.7 million people in Indianapolis are not saved and do not belong to a local church. And pastors are fighting over church members. That's terrible. That's terrible. There is a harvest in the world, but we've got to get out, we've got to witness, and we've got to evangelize. I'm just going to open up the altar. I'm going to stand an altar call. I'm going to ask that every head will be bowed and every eye will be closed. I'm going to talk to some people. And if you're in any of these categories, feel free to come down to the altar. And the first group of people that I'm going to talk to are those of you who are not saved. Yes. Not being saved doesn't mean you're a bad person. Some people who are really good people, they just don't know God.
Yes.
So you don't ever have to feel ashamed for not knowing Christ. Because today you can get to know Him. The Bible says if you confess with your mouth and you believe in your heart that God has raised Jesus from the dead, He said you can be saved. It's that simple. We make it a lot more complicated than what it needs to be. There is a transaction that occurs within your heart. If you're not saved, if you're in this room right now, just lift up your hands and I'm going to pray for you. You say, Pastor Derek, I just want to be saved. I want to get to know God. I want to be a part of the church. I'm not necessarily soliciting for the local church, but I want to get connected to the body of Christ. If that's you and you are in this room right now, just lift up your hands. We're going to pray for you. Not going to embarrass you. We're not going to call you out. You're just saying, I want to be saved. Hallelujah. And the next group of people I want to talk to are those who perhaps you've been saved. Perhaps you've been saved. You've confessed your belief in Jesus Christ, but you have backslid or slipped away from the things of God, which means you are not living a saved life. You know, if Jesus was to come back tonight, you say, I don't know if I would make it or not. That's not a good place to be. If you are in the second category, and you can say, I want to rededicate my life to Christ. I want to get back on the right track. I'm not going to be moved to the right. I'm not going to be moved to the left. If that's you, lift up your hand right now, and we can pray for you, and you can be rededicated to the things of God right here, right now. Don't let the enemy talk you out of it. And finally, the third group of people that I want to talk to are those of you who say, I'm saved. I know God, I know Jesus Christ, and I'm living right, but I'm not connected to a local church. I'm not connected to a local church. And from what I've seen here in this service, I agree with you, Pastor. I agree with the word that you're preaching, and I agree with the move that I see that God is going to do in this ministry. If that's you and you want to be a part of this ministry, we're going to ask that you slip up your hand right now. You're saying, I want to be connected to a local church. Speck sounds like a good church to me. If you're in any of those three categories and you want to walk down to the altar, I'm going to pray and then I'm going to ask that you would just come down, that you would join, that you would get saved or rededicate your life. Father, in the name of Jesus, God, I thank you for this day. I thank you for this service. I thank you for this legacy day. Father, we thank you for your spirit and your presence that's come in this place. Father, we ask right now, God, that you would bless each and every individual in this room. Father, we rebuke fear and we denounce fear openly right now. We release faith into this environment. And Father, we ask right now that they would not allow the enemy to talk them out of a life-changing decision. God, we thank you because we know that you have called us to be the church. God, we're taking off everything that's not like you. And we're putting on everything that pertains to life and godliness. Father, we give you praise. We give you glory. We give you honor in Jesus' name. All right, come down. If that's you, come down right now. Hallelujah. Jesus said, the day that you hear my voice, he says, harden not your heart. He says, behold, I stand at the door of knocking. You should let God in. Don't turn them down. You don't know where death might be. You don't know this could be your last opportunity. If you need to be saved, you need to rededicate your life. You know you're not living right. Now is the perfect day. This is your day. This is your hour. If you want to come down, the altar is open. Service, and we're just so thankful that everyone of you who has come out to be a part of this day, has come out to celebrate us. We are truly thankful. It is overwhelming, the expressions of love that you have given us. We're so thankful for each and every one of you, and I pray that everything that you've sown into being a part of this day, God will give it back to you double fold. Just want to give out a couple of thank yous. I want to thank each and every pastor, first lady who came out to celebrate with us. Pastor Justin Williams. Come on, somebody, give him a hand. Pastor Keith Jones, Pastor Bevan, first lady, you have to step out. We appreciate you guys so much for everything that you're doing. He's probably been one of the most active pastors in the city who has encouraged me, who has been there. Anything I need, advice, wisdom, godly counsel, he said, D, whatever you need, I got you. First lady has been the same with my wife, and we thank you guys so much. It's amazing. It is amazing. He just started a ministry. It's only a little pains, a ministry, but he unreservedly avails himself to anybody who is in need of anything. So we appreciate your heart. And we also want to thank Pastor Bevins. We appreciate everything that you're doing. Appreciate you being here. Pastor Superintendent Elder Dari. Thank you so much. When I accepted my call, they let me come to their church and preach. So I appreciate you taking a chance on me. And the angel of this house, Superintendent Elton Amos. Come on, give him a hand. Beautiful wife. We thank you. We appreciate you guys so much for lending this facility to us, being so open to help move the vision that God has given us. Thank you for all your phone calls, your text messages, your support, your love. He let me know of anything you need. He's right there for me, and I appreciate God for you, everything that you've done. And to this awesome choir, come on. These people are singers. You don't know to start off like that. We got some of the greatest singers and some of the greatest musicians. My wife has called each and every one of them out. Bishop Joshua Humphrey, come on, man. This guy is phenomenal. Play for Mary Mary, Tom Lawrence. Come on, this guy is amazing. My Uncle Vernon, he's like the veteran that became old school. Go back to the 80s, record Bishop Temple. And Emory McVeary, he's the maestro himself. Get Emory a hand. And my brother from another mother, the Juan Cusick, baddest drummer in the city of Indianapolis, Juan Cusick. Man, I appreciate everything that you've done, man, all your encouragement, all your support, your phone calls for life and for ministry. You are awesome, and I thank God for you. And to each and every choir member, Archie, my buddy, my friend, preacher, pastor, Archie. We thank God for him. He is a songster. He is a singer. He is a praise and worship leader. Come on, give him a hand. He's awesome. Sister Cookie, dynamic. Thank you so much. I enjoy Great Praise. She sung that song years and years ago, and she didn't remember, but I fell in love with that song from that point on. And I asked her, I said, what was that song? She said, Great Praise, Stephen Hurd. And I inboxed her a couple of months ago. I said, can you sing Great Praise? She said, I don't know what that song is. She said, I don't remember. That means you singing a whole lot. So Sister Cookie, I thank you. She was so willing to help out. Michelle, Harvest Time. Listen, the first time I heard her sing that, God spoke to me with that song, and I'm not kidding. Listen, everything you need is your harvest time. And she sang that today, and I thank you so much. I appreciate you. Rebecca, Chris, Kyla, gonna be our praise and worship leader. 14 years old, and it's possible. I'm doing something great in my life. Rebecca, Brother Property, my guy, I appreciate you too. You've been such a big help. Bishop Mark, James Mark, we appreciate him. This is Pastor Mark's son, Pastor Mark, Wonder Life Church. Thank you so much for everything that you've done. She helped me so much. I gotta say this, she sold into me when I was a teenager. I had just left my denomination, just left the Church of God in Christ, came to New Life. She sold into me so heavy. I thank God and I thank you for seeing something in me. She gave me an opportunity. She gave me a chance. We would do intercessory prayer every Monday night. And it was already there, but she began to stir it up. She began to cultivate it. And she really taught me how to hear the voice of God. She taught me how to pray. And I just thank you so much for everything that you're doing. I thank you for sowing into so many people. It has not gone unnoticed. And I know that God is going to reward your faithfulness. And she's a savior. Did y'all hear that note? Did y'all hear that note? It's a lot of good. Sister Bunny, Sharon Moore. Come on. Thank you.
Jordan. She is amazing. One of the greatest praise and worship leaders.
You gotta support her. She got a CD coming out. Her first CD was amazing. Glory to your name. She has a CD currently about to come out. It'll be out by June 15th. So make sure you support her. Hit her up on Facebook. If you don't have her page, come through my page. You'll be able to find her. Sister Bunny. So make sure you support her and support her CD. I cannot call each and every name, but please make sure that you come and try and talk to us after service. We'd love to greet you. And Kalandra, thought I forgot. You forget? I got you. Kalandra, we appreciate you. We appreciate your willingness to work, your energy. Call back the whole time. And to each and every one, I gotta say thank you to Pastor Smith, who's also in the house. Appreciate your encouragement and support, First Lady Jackie Smith. We appreciate you guys and everything that you've done for us. And I gotta say thank you to my mom. Thank you to my mom. She's the original, she's the OG. So thank you so much for everything that you've done, your love, your encouragement, your support. Even when it doesn't seem like I'm thankful or appreciative of it, just know that I love you, I thank you. I thank you for everything that you've done for me. Even if I get too busy, we're going to lunch Thursday, Indian food. All right, going to lunch, and my dad, I thank you so much. I think I have the greatest parents in the world. They are so balanced. They are so well-rounded. They have helped us to become naturally and spiritually mature, financially, relationally. They like hit every mark. It's amazing. And to my board of directors, Brother Brandon Hill, Pastor Hill. And evangelist Olivia Hill, we thank you guys so much for coming down, making the trip. They came all the way from out of town. And my brother, Antoine Jones, I appreciate you, man. You got me, and I know that. Anything that I need, he's always there. Pastor Chris, thank you so much for coming out. Mama Kane is in the house. Thank you so much. Gotta say thank you. Thank you so much. It's so great to see you. And evangelist Harley. We gotta say thank you to Harley, because Harley drove from Chicago, Illinois, just to be in the service today, so we appreciate it. Thank you so much. Thank you.
I just want to thank everyone again so much for your time and your support and love, and we definitely solicit your prayers. This is just the beginning, so we pray that you will help us in our mission, God, however you are led to help us, but prayer is the utmost. If you would just pray for us, we know that God will hear prayers and he will summon heaven on our behalf, and that we will be able to go forth in his name. So I just thank you so much. Thank you for this faith, Pastor. We love you all.
All right, she thought I forgot about you. Number one, thank you. Thank you to my wife. I thank you so much, lady. Give me a hand. I thank you so much for all your encouragement. Thank you for all your support. Praying for me even when I don't know it. I thank you for covering me. I thank you for just being my prime rib, for helping me out. I thank you for being willing to follow my leading through God. And I just thank God for you and everything that you've done for me. You've been such a help. I'm better because of you. And I love you. I love you. I love you. I can't say it enough. Father, in the name of Jesus, God, we just thank you for this day. God, we thank you for each and every individual in this room. God, we thank you for the support and the labor of love that was sown today. God, we pray right now, God, that you would continue to bless us. God, we thank you for the vision and the mission, God, that you have given this church. Father, I pray that you would strengthen and empower me through your word. Father, I pray that you would just continue to be glorified in everything that we do and say. I pray that you would, number one, get the glory. No glory belongs to us. And Father, as we leave this place, whenever your presence, bring us back at your appointed time, and we'll give you all praise, we'll give you all glory and honor in Jesus' name. Come on, somebody say amen.
Darling, let's go get him.
Give me that joy I can't explain, an extra peace that'll ease my pain. Want that love that'll never change. Give me that,
give me that,
give me that,
give me that.
Give me that power to walk away when another God wants to take your place. As much of you as I can take. Give me that,
give me
that.
Anybody ready? Ready for his glory? If you are sick of your life, let me tell you the story. Every place that's dark,
oh, oh, oh.
He fighters, liars, time to get right. See, I clean myself. I cast my own stone. I'm the man in the mirror, y'all. I can see my wrong. But I'm here by grace, through Christ by faith. I had to make that choice. I had to open up my mouth and say,
give me that joy I can't explain. Add extra peace that'll ease my pain. Want that love that'll never change. Give me that,
give me that,
give me that,
give me that,
give me that power to walk away when another God wants to take your place. As much of you as I can take. Give me that,
give me that,
give me that, give me that.
Oh, anybody tired?
Oh,
you want the show to end?
Oh,
get the actors off stage.
Oh,
and let church begin.
Oh,
do you want a revolution?
Oh,
you want to hear new?
Pastor, what's up, man? This is Emery. Just wanted to make sure that I told you that I love you, man. I'm praying for you. You're a great guy. You're a great man. You're a great husband. So I know God is going to be using you mightily. We love you, man. Take it easy. You see LaJuan jumped in my
head. What up, Derek? Just wanted to say congratulations, man. You did a great job tonight. And nothing else I can say, man. Brother, I love you, man. Again, if you need anything, man, just let me know. All the late night phone calls, man. If you need me, bro, just let me know. I love you again. Love you, man.
Pastor Snodgrass, this is your boy, Chris Jackson. Love you, man. Stay blessed, stay encouraged. And I know you're a man after God's own heart. The Jackson family, my wife, Chris, we all love you. Thank you.
Yo, homeboy, Pastor Snodgrass, thank you so much, man, for having me. Definitely enjoyed being here again. No other place I would rather be today. Here with you to celebrate your first service, man. I'm looking forward to
is that his nickname?
All the great things that God has to talk to you and your family.
Okay.
Anything you need. My family.